Once again, thank you very much for hosting Liferay. We're very, very pleased to be here. Thank you to Savoir-Faire Linux, our partner. Savoir-Faire has been working with Liferay, has a history with Liferay about 4 years now, two of those years as a partner of Liferay. They were the recipients of the Community Excellence Award in 2011, and they've worked on, I think, over 25, maybe 30 projects, Liferay projects, over the years. We're very pleased to be here, very pleased with our relationship with Savoir-Faire for this particular market. And I'm here today to kind of give you an overview of Liferay, tell you a little bit about our technology, some of the new features in our latest release, before turning over to the projects themselves. So with that, let me just begin. Also, if I'm speaking too quickly, please raise your hand, let me know. I'll be more than happy to slow down. If you have any questions, please feel free to interrupt me. I don't mind. I'd rather you ask a question while it's on your mind, and then to hold it and perhaps not get it answered. We're here to answer these questions. We're here to present information to you. So this roadshow is for you. So beginning with Liferay, if you're not familiar with Liferay, we are the open source leader for enterprise portal technology. We define that as a horizontal portal. The definition of a horizontal portal by the analysts in the industry is a horizontal platform, a single entry point into this platform that can host a variety of enterprise web needs. Our technology is not biased towards any particular vertical market. It is applicable, the functionality is applicable in any market, whether it's financial, healthcare, commercial, e-commerce, B2B, B2C, whatever the case may be. And as we go into the product, the technology itself and the capabilities themselves, you'll see that this is going to be borne out. But really, from the open source side of the fence, there's really only two offerings for a true horizontal portal. There's Liferay and there's JBoss. JBoss has largely become irrelevant in terms of where they're at with their portal technology, with their updating of new features in their technology. There's a little graph here. I think you can see it up there. Basically, just based on number of downloads over the past decade, if you can see where Liferay has been, we've been trending upwards over the past decade. And just in terms of looking at people that are downloading Liferay versus those downloading JBoss, while JBoss has remained fairly flat over the past decade, the interest and the buzz and the downloads for Liferay has been on an upward trend, on a dramatic upward trend. This next slide just kind of gives you a very high-level logical overview of what Liferay is. If you imagine there's a black line here, if you imagine that's being the platform, and on top of the Liferay platform, you can build any B2B, B2C, BDE type of website types of applications, whatever they might be, whether it's internal, external facing. We have a roles-based content delivery system that allows you to build hierarchy organizational sites into your site, whether it's a corporate site, whether it's a partner or client site. Whether it's breaking down one particular department into different hierarchical groups. Everything is driven by our roles-based permissioning that allows you to very tightly control on a granular level what a particular user or group of users sees or doesn't see. Social applications, the collaboration piece of Liferay, whether it's you're using it for your internal sales and engineering or whether you're using it for customers. We'll be showing you a little bit of that too as well. And ERP portals, any kind of EIA type of portal, type of application. And then, of course, underneath the platform, we're supported by web services, API calls, JSR 286 portlet standard, whether you're integrating a back-end ERP, accounting, HR, CRM package. And then on the other side, we're also able to aggregate other applications, other websites, Salesforce, PeopleSoft, whatever the case may be for your particular organization. So what we're really trying to show here is how Liferay can be, due to its flexibility for integration, it can be an aggregator for many disparate systems. If you're coming from a legacy type of application, you have Salesforce and PeopleSoft and maybe SAP, and you need to pull everything together, Liferay is a good platform to be able to aggregate all of these different applications, these different functions, these different data repositories into a single user interface, into a single administration interface, into a single view that you can publish out to your users. And then, of course, once you bring it in, Liferay handles all the authorizations and all the content authorizations via our roles-based permissioning. So some of the main reasons for adoption of Liferay: modular web application development. We do make it very, very easy for you to develop in Liferay. We provide a developer studio, that was what we called it, which is essentially an Eclipse-based IDE with Liferay-specific plugins deployed to make it easy for people that perhaps don't have a lot of Java background, moving in from maybe perhaps the .NET or PHP world, to have a graphical interface, a wizard-driven interface to be able to do your development of any kind, whether it's customizing existing features in Liferay, whether it's building new features within Liferay, whether it's integrating other types of applications or websites, etc. We can develop in any language, integrate any application. There's never any limitations in terms of the integration from Liferay's perspective. We have an open API. We provide all the plugins, SDKs. We provide all the source code. We provide all the tools that will allow you to integrate any external third-party application. The only limitations you're ever going to run into are really from that third-party source, whether they're providing APIs to you, whether they're providing an SDK to you. But from Liferay's side, it's completely open. And that really is something that comes from our open source legacy. We embrace the idea of allowing you to customize and extend Liferay to make it work for your organization, as opposed to dictating to you what our vision for you is, what your portal should be, what your website should be, what your social site should be. We'll give you all the flexibility to do what you need to do for yourselves. We do have an identity-based content delivery, as I mentioned, a very fine-grained roles-based permissioning system that I'll hopefully show you here shortly. Any kind of social identity application development that you can do within Liferay. Depth of UI tooling and the design focus of Liferay. We give you tools for the UI. We have something called Alloy UI, which is a toolkit that goes along with the developer studio that I mentioned as part of the development tools. These are it's based on the UI standards, but basically it's a whole toolkit of pre-built components that allows you to very rapidly build new portlets or extend portlets or build web applications. All of the code can be encapsulated for reuse. This whole idea, this paradigm of create once and use many, many times is something that you'll find permeates all the way through Liferay. Our approach and our philosophy is not to force you to redo repetitive tasks over and over again, but rather allow you to build something once, whether it's creating a piece of content, whether it's creating a piece of HTML, whether it's creating a custom portlet, to be able to reuse what you've done as many times as you want to really speed up the whole development cycle. And then, of course, the quality and depth of the product itself. There's two versions of Liferay. There's the community edition of Liferay, and there's also an enterprise version of Liferay. Both versions are built off the same trunk, but the enterprise version of Liferay, which is the one that is supported, is actually trunked off, and once it's branched off, it becomes its own code base. It's actually a distinct branch of the code, and it goes into our own QA process. We have a facility out in California that we have banks and banks of, I think, 250 Hudson servers set up with every possible conceivable stack that you can imagine, whether it's a Solaris stack, Linux stack, Windows stack, all set up different databases, different app servers, and all different configurations. The enterprise code goes and gets crunched through that process on a 24/7 basis. Basically, what we're trying to do is break the code, find the bugs, find the weaknesses, find the vulnerabilities. And what comes out of that is a much more stable, much more optimized, much more hardened version of Liferay that is suitable for the types of enterprise clients that came to us really looking for something a little bit more professional than the community edition. This is not to say the community edition is not a valid edition. It's a very powerful tool. Most of our innovation, the cutting edge technology, is happening on the community. However, for those enterprises looking for a stable, business ready, enterprise ready version of Liferay, we do offer the enterprise version. So the model is not unlike Red Hat versus Red Hat Enterprise or MySQL versus MySQL Enterprise. We have the same type of model in the two different types, two different versions. This next slide, just a small sampling, high-level view of some of our customers. And really what I wanted to show here is just the idea that we are horizontal in nature. As you can see from this slide, we've got customers ranging from gaming to financial to educational to commercial, everything from Harvard Business School, York University, to EA Sports, E-Trade Financial. Most of these customers are using Liferay in more than than as a single capacity. Because Liferay is a platform that offers so many different types of functionalities all bundled within Liferay, a CMS, the social collaboration aspect, multi-tenanting, the pure portal play, all these different functionalities that come bundled with Liferay. Some of our customers will use Liferay simply as a CMS. For instance, Sesame Street was one of our largest customers. They're one of our oldest customers. It's obviously they have a very targeted market, but it's actually a very high traffic site where they get about 1.8 million hits a day. They're pushing about 2 terabytes of data every day through our CMS to their customers. So it's a very robust site. It's been around for quite a few years, and as a matter of fact, we're upgrading them now to 6.1. All the way to some companies like Cisco, for instance, they have about 5 or 6 different Liferay deployments. Primarily, Cisco is using us as a social collaboration network. If you go to the social developer network, you'll see that that's built on Liferay, and it's a simple collaboration site that allows different developers within the Cisco community across the world to be able to collaborate, get on forums, and exchange ideas, et cetera. There are customers of ours that get into Liferay for one reason and then discover that there's other features. For instance, not on here, one of our customers is Blue Cross Blue Shield, which is an insurance company down in the U.S. They originally purchased Liferay as an intranet. They started using Liferay as an intranet and then discovered, wow, I've got a free CMS here. And it's a very powerful CMS. Why am I not using it? Why do I have to pay another license to use it? Because I already have it with Liferay. So right now, they're migrating everything from SharePoint over to our CMS and be able to host everything on Liferay. This is just kind of another idea of the value that you get with Liferay. Instead of having to maintain multiple licenses, multiple different types of technologies, because we pack so much into Liferay, you can do so much with Liferay. When you get into Liferay, you can eventually migrate all of these different functionalities into Liferay and have a single platform to maintain. 6.1 is our current shipping version. It is the culmination of about 11 years, actually 12 years of development. So although we are a young company, we've only been incorporated since 2004, the Liferay project actually began in the year 2000. Our chief software architect, Brian Chan, started developing Liferay for a nonprofit organization he was involved in. And he went out at that time, back in 2000, and tried to purchase a portal, and couldn't afford, didn't have the money to purchase what was available at that time. At that time, portals were a little bit different than they are right now. So he decided to build his own with the features that he wanted. That basic code that he started with in 2000 has largely remained the same over all these years. Of course, it's been optimized. A lot more has been added to it. It's been expanded, bug fixes, etc. But essentially, the code has got about 10, 12 years of maturity behind it. So it's not a new product. It's not something that we just created in the last couple of years. It has some legs. It has some history. From that perspective, it does have some maturity as far as the portal product is concerned. We are a lightweight web platform. We are considered a lean portal. The whole download is a couple hundred megabytes, and we're talking about the full enterprise edition with all the plugins, with all the features, with all the bundle capability. Compare that to, say, Oracle Web Center, I think, is 3 DVDs of install, and then after you install, you have to actually configure all the different pieces and put it all together to make it work. Whereas Liferay, you extract it, you hook it up to whatever database you want, or you use our internal database, and you're up and running. We do have an integrated workflow. It is our own workflow engine. Hopefully, I'll be showing it to you here shortly. It's called the Kaleo workflow engine with some premium features that you generally won't find in a bundled workflow application. Advanced publishing features that we'll be talking a little bit about. We do have multi-device support. We have a detection layer that goes into the whole mobile strategy of how Liferay is very, very mobile friendly. We have the ability to detect what type of device you're accessing a particular website with, in a system of mobile device rules that you can apply, such as if somebody hits our site with an iPad, then do this, or somebody hits our site with an Android, then do this. This whole system is built into Liferay and kind of cooked into the content creation. Business-defined content types, the ability to actually go and make a definition for perhaps a Word document. It's not simply a Word document, but it's a sales order, or it's a white paper, whatever the case may be, once you are able to actually assign a particular business context to your documents, it enriches that metadata layer for how you manage documents. It's not just a folder with a bunch of PDFs or not just a folder with a bunch of doc files, but rather it's a folder of sales orders, it's a folder of POs, it's a folder of technical documents, however you decide to do that, and I'll be showing you that as well. User customizable pages. This is the ability to allow your individual end user to dictate what they want to see on their page. So very much like Google, you can have a portion of the page that you designate that says, I want to rearrange my page this way. I want to see a weather ticker here, maybe a stock ticker here. I want to be able to see this portlet but not that portlet. That's all customizable. You can push that down to your actual users. So very quickly, some of the key features of Liferay 6.1, the content management piece, collaboration services, blogs, wikis, message boards, the ease of extensibility, ease of integration, the ease of administration that we'll be showing you as well, the design and usability of Liferay, how easy it is to actually use, not just from a development point of view, but as your users come into Liferay, the low learning curve, analytics and management that's built into Liferay. So with that, let me just hop in very quickly to the first bullet here, which is the web content management. And instead of kind of reading through this, I'm just going to really quickly run into, jump over here and show you. This is my live Liferay instance. It's actually running on my laptop. It's a MacBook Pro. This is the full Enterprise Edition, so you can see it's a very lightweight, does not require a whole lot of hardware to actually run. But I just want to show you a couple things real quickly about the web content. I have some sample content built in here and some sample users built in here. I'm going to log in as my top-level administrator. His name is Bruno. Bruno, by the way, is actually an employee of Liferay. He's an engineer in our Brazil office, but he's a known more widely as Bruno Admin. He's been our default administrator for many, many, many years, many versions of Liferay. Actually, there's some very funny stories about Bruno. He was actually traveling in Europe one year, and somebody saw him actually in the public. It was a market or something, and said, "Are you Bruno Admin?" And he was like, "So obviously, there's a lot of people out there using Liferay, and they actually recognized him from his picture and said, "I know you. You're Bruno Admin." And he says, "Yeah, that's me." So I'm logged in as Bruno, my top level administrator, and as such, you can see that all these various portlets have some edit controls here. I can actually come in here and manage these different portlets. But what I really want to show you here is just the ease of being able to add new pages. This is a sample site that we've built out. But as you can see, it's fairly easy for me to add a page without any kind of technical knowledge at all. I'm not a technical person. I'm just a sales guy. So even I can add a page here. But these things that I'm showing you here are basically the portlets, the applets or applications that are bundled with Liferay. They're all JSR 286 compliant, Java standard compliant. As you can see, there's about 70 some portlets that's bundled with Liferay that comes by default. And they're broken down by different types of usage. For instance, BI, collaboration type portlets, web content management. For the time being, I'm just going to pull up a web content display portlet and show you just the ease of being able to deploy. It's all drag and drop. And of course, I don't have to stick with web content. I can build a mashup page fairly easily of different types of features. I can have a bloggers. I can have a document gallery. Basically, as you can see, it's all drag and drop, a calendar. And then once I've deployed it, I can rearrange it very easily. The ease of use, really, in terms of using Liferay, building pages, doesn't require any kind of technical knowledge. Once I've done that, I can actually go and, if I don't like that particular layout, I can change my layouts. These are just some sample layouts I have within my demo environment, but you can create as many different layouts as you want. You can extend these layouts to whatever your needs are. But the idea here is that you can push this out, and once you've pushed it out, it becomes available for your users to use and change. So I've created something called a web content display portlet. I just want to give you a real quick view of how easy it is to actually come in and create content. So I've created a portlet. I'm displaying a portlet. I'm going to come and create some new content. And as you can see, we have a WYSIWYG editor here. Again, for your content creation people, there's not a huge learning curve. There's no need to understand HTML. They can create what you see is what you get type of editor. Everybody knows how to use something like this. Everybody's seen it before. They know that B means bold. They can change their text types. They can change their font sizes, et cetera, et cetera. And then publishing it out, it's just really that easy. I've created a new piece of content. Now, of course, this doesn't really show you much. But I also want to talk very quickly about the idea of how content, once you've created content, it's not simply a static piece of content sitting on a page. It goes into a repository that becomes then available to be republished over and over and over again. This idea of create once, publish many times, create once, use many times. That's true whether it's a piece of web content, whether it's a development effort, a development project, whether it's a blog post, a wiki post, a message board article. This all becomes available. Any asset that you create within the portal becomes available as an asset to be published or used again wherever you want. So I've created a piece of content here, but I'm going to come down here and actually select another piece of content that I created earlier just to see. Sorry, forgive me 1 second. There we go. Let me see if I can find it here very quickly. It must be on the next page. All right, so I'm selecting a piece of content called Welcome Mike that I actually created earlier. And if that looks kind of familiar, it's also the same content that I'm showing here on my Welcome page. So as you can see, this same piece of content I'm actually deploying in two different places here. I can deploy that on any page that I want. I can deploy that on any website that I want. If I wanted to have it available for the global scope, I can scope it up to the global scope and have it available across many, many different types of websites. Perhaps you have a press release that needs to be published across multiple departmental websites. You would put it in the global scope. Or you can scope it down to as narrow as you want. For instance, if you have a piece of content that's only supposed to be available to a particular website or even a particular page, you can scope it down so that it's not available. It's up to you. You control that. The idea here is that asset is a persistent asset within the portal. Even if I deleted this portlet or deleted this page, this particular piece of content would persist. As you can see, I've got some edits already in here, but I want to show you this idea of being able to come in here, and now looking at our WYSIWYG editor here, you can see that I've got graphics, I've got links, I've got different types of content, font types, and if I'm going to come in here and create... I already have, actually had some left over from my last demo, create some edits. I can publish it out very quickly. And once I've done that, you can see that this new edits that I've created appear in both places where I have this particular piece of content displayed. And this is true whether I have it displayed 10 times, 15 times, once or twice, doesn't matter. If I wanted to apply workflow to it, let me just show you very quickly, get into the workflow aspect of our workflow engine. I'm going to show you our workflow creation, workflow configuration screen. These are assets that I have available to apply workflow to. We're certainly not limited to this. You can extend this list to cover any custom content or custom asset that you create. You can apply workflow to basically any asset that you have, any activity that you have, whether it's an activity associated with a particular piece of content or document or even a process, you can apply workflow to. So in this case right now, I'm going to come to web content here, and I'm going to apply workflow to this particular piece of this particular asset or asset type, which is a content. Once I've applied this now, I can go back. And I want to show you how this works. I'm going to sign out as Bruno. And I'm going to sign back in as Michelle. Michelle is my editor. So she has her role is the content creation role, or the editor role. And as such, she's going to come in here to this piece of content and perhaps make some changes. And we're going to say these are going to be Michelle's edits. Okay? And she's going to come here and she's going to publish that out. Let me see. Is workflow turned on? I forgot to save that. Let me come back to Bruno. And what I did wrong, I forgot to save my workflow configuration. Let me come back here. Workflow, web content, single approver. There we go. Now it's working. So I'm going to come back in here and sign back in as Michelle. And her edits already came in, so let's make some more edits. Okay, and you can see that she no longer has the ability to publish, but rather she's has to submit for publication because workflow has been turned on for web content. Once we've done that, you see her new edits have not actually shown up. So we're going to sign out as Michelle and sign back in as Richard. Richard is our publisher, so he has the role of being able to approve content. So we're going to log in as Richard. Richard's going to go to his control panel. And as you can see, he doesn't have nearly as much access to different things that he can do as an administrator. But one thing he does have access to is his workflow tasks. So we see now that there's a workflow task that's been assigned to the role of publisher. There may be multiple publishers. So as such, Richard's going to come in very quickly and assign this particular task to himself. And once he's done that, he sees assigned to me right now, I've got a review task. The asset title is called Welcome Mike, which is what the one we picked. The asset type is web content, the last activity date, and a due date. Richard, at this point, has the ability to approve, reject, reassign, or update the due date. So let's say we're going to approve it. He's going to say, good job, Michelle. Put a little note to her, OK. And let's go back to Liferay, and we see that her poor spelling has been published out. So as such, we see that how workflow has been applied in a very simplistic way to web content. But let me log back in as Bruno here real quickly one more time and go back to my my dialog box for my web content. He comes in here and says, wow, this is really poor spelling and, you know, I can't have this. We can go back and look at the history. Okay, we see in here that there's a whole history of different things that has been done. And he says, we have to roll this back. All right, so we're going to delete, maybe we're going to delete a number of versions and roll it back to an earlier version of the content and roll it all the way back to maybe version 1.1. So managing versions is something that's very easy within Liferay. It's built in versioning history. So we're back. Actually, we're probably roll back one more time to an earlier version of Liferay. I mean, the earlier version of this particular piece of content. But as you can see, what we have in here a history of the versioning. However many edits that you do, you can always roll back. You have the ability to retrace your steps. This is true for web content. This is also true for any other types of assets that you have as well. Versioning is built in. So just very quickly, some features about web content. Let me move on to the next couple of slides here. I talked a little bit about this. We have structures and templates. The way the structures and templates works within Liferay, let me show you that very quickly. Basically, structures and templates is the ability to create a structured content. So for instance, if you have, let's say for instance, you have a press release and you have that press release that you want to maintain the same logo, the same font, the same look and feel, so you have continuity from one press release to the next. You can actually determine that in a structure or a template, or a structure and a template, and have that available so that your content creator doesn't have to worry about formatting. To give you an idea of how that works, this is just a piece of sample content that we have in here. I'm going to come in here and go to my edit screen. I've already got a couple of different templates already set up for this piece of structure. So let's say I want to move the image to the right. I need to publish. I need to turn that out. Submit for publication. Let me go to my workflow here and turn this off very quickly and approve this. Okay, it's been approved. Let me just turn my workflow off so we don't keep running into that. No workflow. Save. Okay. I don't know if you noticed this, but this piece of content, the image has moved from the left to the right. Let me just pull up another template real quickly as well. Let me try image left, but with a larger title. Okay, if I publish that out, you can see that I've changed the content of the title. So the idea here is that you can create structured content so that you control how that particular piece of content is going to look. And then once you push that template out to your content creators, all they're worried about is writing the text. And you can control what size font. This is the idea behind the using structures and templates to be able to control your content.
This stumble box is from 6.1.
Yeah, the dialog box has changed slightly in 6.1 in both versions of Community and Enterprise Edition. So this dialog box has changed a little bit here. All right, so it looks a little bit different, but all the features are there. There are some new features that have been added in 6.1, but in 6.0 to 6.1, this looks a little bit different. But the structures and templates were available in both versions. Content sharing, I talked about a little bit how content is not a static content, but it actually can be shared across your global repository. We have something called an asset publisher portlet. Basically, it's the ability to show any content type within a portlet. You can show, you can deploy an asset publisher and have every single piece of content you have in your portal displayed as an abstract, or you can filter it down by content type, you can filter it by category, you can filter it by creator. Let's say, for instance, you want to have a portlet that displays only blogs, and you want to be able to display only blogs from a particular blogger, and you want to display only blogs from a particular blogger over the last 2 weeks. You have the ability to drill down and filter by all those different criteria, and so that portlet, once you've set it up, it will automatically, dynamically update that content every time a new blog from that blogger comes up, every time the 2 weeks passes, whatever criteria you've set. So it's a very interesting portlet, very powerful portlet for you to be able to display lots of different types of information. One thing that you could do is, for instance, display an asset publisher portlet that shows a view of videos you have stored, for instance. And perhaps you want to format that portlet to show a thumbnail of each video, and then perhaps you want to have a thumbnail of each video with a small abstract underneath it. So basically what you've created is a YouTube landing page. You can do that with asset publisher. No development, it's just configuration. So a very interesting portlet. Multi-repository integration. One of the new features of 6.1 is this idea of a pluggable repository architecture. Via the CMIS protocol, we now have the ability of not simply using our document library to add files and folders. I'm just going to pull this up and actually show you very quickly. Not just files and folders, but actually being able to map in complete third-party repositories. So, for instance, I can come in and map in just with a URL, a Documentum repository, a SharePoint repository, maybe it's an Alfresco repository. Any type of content management system that supports CMIS can be surfaced within Liferay. The powerful nature of this is this idea that you don't necessarily have to migrate your existing technology into Liferay. If you're already a SharePoint house, if you're already a Documentum house, Liferay can be deployed alongside of those different types of technologies without you necessarily having to migrate content into Liferay, but you can surface that content in Liferay, have it available in Liferay, and once you've brought it into Liferay, as far as your users in the portal is concerned, they're just seeing it as another folder. They don't know that they're going to necessarily a SharePoint folder or perhaps going out to a Documentum folder. And of course, once you've brought it into the portlet framework of Liferay, Liferay is taking over all the authorizations, taking over all the management of who gets to see what. So a very powerful feature in terms of being able to leverage existing technologies. And again, this kind of plays into this whole idea of low cost of adoption. If you already have SharePoint deployed, you don't have to give up your SharePoint. If you already have some other CMS deployed, you don't have to give that up. Liferay will work alongside with it and leverage all the strengths of that and allow you to still be able to use Liferay for what you need it for. Usability as far as content management, each individual users can change their views of the repository folders. You have inline preview of documents, inline preview of that metadata. Document metadata is very easy to find, very easy to create. Every piece of document, every folder has the ability to create a very rich metadata layer that then can be indexed and searched on. We make collaborating on documents very easy. We've got check-in, check-out features. In many ways, Liferay is approaching ECM capabilities. We're not saying that we are an ECM. We're not competing in that space. We don't necessarily want to compete in that space. However, we're offering features in Liferay that allow you to really pull a lot of different components, whether it's pulling in workflow, pulling in the ability to have the pluggable repository, pulling in the ability to create custom content types, business content types. We also have the ability to make on-the-fly relationships between types of assets. For instance, you have a sales order type of content, and you want to have a relationship between the sales order and a legal contract. So your salesperson goes and he says, "Hey, I want to close this deal. I'm going to fill out the sales order. Boom, I'm going to submit it." You can create a relationship to it that says, no, you can't do that because you need to have a legal contract executed first. And then you create a workflow that ties the one piece of content to the other that are related that says, sales order cannot be executed until the contract is signed. So then you can see you're pulling in all different functions, these different pieces of Liferay, and giving you the basis to be able to create your own content management application, enterprise content management application. So a very interesting way that Liferay has really kind of upped its game as far as document management, some of the features that we have. User data lists are very much like SharePoint lists. The ability to create on the fly user lists that basically it's really more of a way to build very quick applications within Liferay that allow you to leverage lists and leverage records and leverage responses and input to that without any kind of development. Actually, it's probably easier for me to show you than it is to actually talk about it. So I'm going to, back in here is Bruno, and I'm going to go into my control panel, and I'm going to show you how the dynamic data lists work. So let's say, for instance, the first thing I want to do is I want to create a definition. And perhaps, I have a definition already created, but let me just say I'm going to create a new definition called roadshows. All right, and actually, let me just add it in here. I'm going to call this a roadshow, and maybe it's a roadshow registration. Let's call it roadshow registration. Am I spelling this correctly? Okay, so I've got a definition called roadshow. So as you can see, I've pulled up a palette here that allows me to very quickly create a form that allows me to just kind of use a palette and create a quick form for this particular record, or this template, if you will. And maybe I want to come in here and change the name of this one to and call this description. Very flexible in terms of what you want to be able to do with these different fields. And maybe this one we're going to come in here and call this name. Okay. And we've created a little form here, and we're going to save this form off. And this is our definition, our template, or if you will. And then I'm going to create a new data list. All right, and we're going to call this Montreal Roadshow Registration. All right, and I'm going to select the data definition that I just created. I just created something called Roadshow. I'm going to select that as my template, and maybe I'm going to apply a workflow to it. And once I've saved that off, I've created this this particular user data list. Let me go to my page over here and display and deploy something called a dynamic data list display. All right, I'm going to pull that out here. And I've deployed a portlet that now I can go and select my roadshow, my Montreal roadshow record form. All right, so now I've got a form that's built out here that any user can come in now and add a record. Okay, he clicks on the record and today's date. It has a date picker, option one, option two, option three, whatever that might be. Up to you to decide. Description: I'm going to a roadshow, and my name. Okay, so as you can see, I have to submit this for publication because I've got workflow attached to it. So as you can see, I can have a record built out here. And as more people come in, the more this record actually extends and builds out. But you can see that I've just built a small form that without any development, without any kind of technical expertise, and you can build this for whatever you want, an RSVP list, you can use it for e-commerce applications, for you can use it for basically anything that you want to do as far as building lists, building forms, and you can make this as complex as you want. You can have multiple workflows attached to it. You can have multiple stages of workflow attached to it. You can use it for subscription to prescription medicine. You can use it for doctors doing rounds in a hospital and checking blood pressure and entering information in there, how many times a patient has received their medication, lots of different applications of how you can use user lists. But the idea here is that it doesn't require any technical expertise. Your business users can create this with just a little bit of training. So really neat, new, powerful new features as far as the user data list is concerned. Business-defined content types, I spoke about that really earlier, but I just want to show you one more time real quickly. There we go. The ability to create business-defined content types. So again, not simply having an image or having, here's Bruno's image here, you can actually come in here and define a particular content type. I mentioned earlier that these are just some sample content types I have in here. I mentioned earlier that we can create context for documents. So let me say I want to come in here and I want to say admin avatars. Okay, so first I'm going to create a specific content type called admin avatars. And then I can come in here. Once again, I have the same palette in here. I can add in whatever features that I want or fields that I want for this particular type of content. And let me say I want to come back in here and change this to role type. All right, maybe he's a role, and I'm going to come in here and change this to name. And same palette, same concept, same idea. Once I've saved that off, now when I come and actually add something to this folder, I can actually say, instead of adding just a document or a basic document, I can say I'm going to add an admin avatar. And now I can upload a file that goes into that folder as a specific type of image, not just a regular image. Now, of course, this is very simplistic in terms of what I'm doing here, but you can see the implications here. Whether you're uploading whatever file you're trying to manage, whether it's an API, perhaps it's an SDK, perhaps it's a piece of code, perhaps it's some kind of document, legal document, you can apply different types of context to it. And once you've done that, you have the ability to have all this metadata available to you for this particular piece of content type that now can be searched and indexed. So very rich ability to have all this built into the way we manage content within Liferay.
Do you support videos also?
Absolutely. You can use, let me just show you very quickly. You can integrate Vimeo, YouTube, you can integrate using our WCMS and play videos through that as well. So it's all supported within Liferay. One thing I want to mention, though, if you're going to do high traffic streaming, you're probably going to want to use a video caching server or something like that. Liferay, from its document system out to play, it will play, but if you have high traffic, then you're probably going to want to have some kind of a server. Let's see, did I talk about advanced publishing? Advanced publishing, yes, very quickly. In Liferay 6.0, we introduced something called staging. That's internal staging. So very much like a development process where you might have a development integration server to a staging server, and then from that staging server, all the final changes are done before it's pushed live. We have that built into Liferay. So within the instance of Liferay, you can actually have a staged site. What it's actually doing behind the scenes is actually copying your site and putting it in a hidden site. And what you're actually working on is the hidden version of that site, and then you can tell exactly by color coding whether you're in the staged site or the live site. And then once you're ready to go live, you can publish that live. You can publish that live to your local instance, or you can publish that live remotely to another Liferay server if you want. And then you can apply workflow to that staging as well that says you can't go live until you have X amount of different people that are signed off on it, et cetera, et cetera. One of the new features in Liferay as far as the staging is concerned in 6.1 is the ability to branch the staging. You can have multiple branches of a particular stage site. You can have multiple versions of a stage site. So, for instance, you're a retail type of site, and you have maybe a fall campaign, a winter campaign, a spring campaign, and a summer campaign. Different looks and feel for your website. The winter one has snow. The summer one has green leaves, whatever the case may be. You can have four versions of your website ready to go with all your content updated and just simply publish one live when the time comes. You can have it even automatically publish live. So, or perhaps you're doing some kind of a UAT, user acceptance testing. You can have multiple versions of a website and you have a user acceptance population that are saying, no, I don't like this one. Oh, this colors look bad. Yeah, this is the right one. Whatever the case may be, you can use that staging mechanism to be able to do that kind of stuff and have it all updated, yet not live. And then as soon as a decision is made to publish it live, you can retire your live site and publish the new one live. You can do it locally and remotely. So some of the new versions. You can actually also then take a branch and merge it back into a single site if you want. Two features or two different branches merge back in. All of these things are available within the staging capacities of Liferay's content management. Faceted search. We have the ability to do faceted search that's being handled on the Liferay side. By default, Liferay uses the Lucene search engine. However, you can plug in any search engine you want. You can plug in Solr, you can plug in a Google search appliance. Whatever you want to use as a search engine, we still handle the faceting on our end. So it doesn't really matter what search engine you use. You can have the availability of faceted search. And really, the faceted search is being driven by it's being driven by your metadata layer. So for instance, if I come into my little demo here, I'm gonna put in Liferay. But this font is so small on my screen, I can't see it. Gonna come in here and search Liferay. Okay, so I've just searched the term Liferay, and this is just my local content here. But as you can see, I can drill down. It's faceted by calendar events. Maybe I only want to see Liferay based on calendar events, maybe I want to see Liferay based on white papers. So basically, the faceting allows you to index down and drill down very quickly to specific facets, and all of that's driven by the metadata. So the richer your metadata is for your particular content, the more facets you're going to have. And again, the idea of each particular content type, you have the ability to have a very large and thick metadata layer. But faceted search, again, is built in by Liferay regardless of what search engine you wind up using. Let me see here. Related content, I spoke about that earlier. The ability to go into a particular piece of content and create relationships. Let me just go back to my document library. All right, so for instance, if I'm going to pull up a white paper here. Taking us some time. There we go. So this is my preview of my white paper. And if I go into and click on the edit mode, I can come in here and say what assets are related to this particular white paper. I can choose really any asset that's available within Liferay. Right now, these are assets that we have by default out of Liferay. We've got blogs, message boards, web content, calendar events. You can extend this to any custom content type that you like. So, for instance, you can make an asset that you can relate a blog post to a video, for instance, or perhaps you're gonna have a message board post and relate that to a wiki article. Whatever content types you have, you can create these relationships between the two so that when someone goes and looks at a particular piece of content or a particular asset, they can immediately see that there's other related assets that allows them to then click on those links and pull that asset up. And then, of course, you can apply workflow between those assets, as I was mentioning earlier. You can't do this until you do that with the related assets. You can't fill out a sales order until you've signed a contract. You can't comment on this message board post until you've viewed the video. Whatever it is that you want to be able to do to tie workflow and link these two assets in. Related content. Liferay Sync is a new feature in 6.1. As a matter of fact, it just went into release not very long ago, a couple weeks ago. It's actually in release right now. But essentially what Liferay Sync is you're familiar with Dropbox. Dropbox is very, very prevalent. A lot of different people use it. Most corporations do not allow their employees to use Dropbox. Why? Because your data's out in the cloud. Who knows where Dropbox is keeping their stuff? They say it's secure. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. I keep all my files on Dropbox. But my stuff is not that important, all right? But most corporations, most enterprises say, don't use Dropbox, you're not allowed to use it. Liferay Sync allows you to have that same ubiquity to create a localized version piece of your content on your laptop, on your iPhone, on your tablet, whatever it is, to have a local copy of it that automatically syncs to your Liferay server. So think of it in terms of Dropbox, but behind the firewall, behind your firewall, because it's syncing to your Liferay server. So just let me show you very quickly. I've got Dropbox and Liferay sync loaded here. But this is my local folder here. All right, this is on my local machine here. I've got a sync site. I've got documents. I've got a bunch of stuff in here. Now I'm going to go back to. Actually, let me log out as Bruno and log in as myself on my demo environment and show you how that works very quickly. I'm going to go to my Liferay Sync site. How am I doing on time? Going to my Liferay Sync site. Okay, so here's my sync folder here. I've got these different documents in here that are being as part of my sync site. So I'm going to take a look at this. This is a white paper called Identity Management. I'm going to come down in here and, Actually, I need to come in as my. I didn't give myself administrative rights for that site. So let me come back in as Bruno to Liferay's to this site, and now I can come in and if I come in and delete this particular document, you can see that that is going to sync very quickly, and it just deleted out of here as well. I know it's not a very good demo, but you can see that basically the and it would also be deleted on my iPhone, on my iPad, whatever the case may be. So in other words, it works just like Dropbox, except it allows you to do it in a safe and secure manner. Now, the other neat thing about Liferay Sync is the fact that you can, you know how in Dropbox you have to have one particular Dropbox, and you have to log back out and log back into a different one if you have to manage a different one. Liferay Sync allows you to manage multiple sites that you can sync to. So for the Enterprise Edition, I can actually sync to as many different sites as I want at the same time simultaneously. The Community Edition of Liferay Sync only allows you to sync to one site at a time. But you have the option to be able to very quickly just change whatever sync site you want to sync to, and I'll be able to update it. I'm running out of time here real quick. All right, so I need to move a little quicker. I'm not even halfway through. So ease of administration. Dynamic site templates is something built into Liferay, ability to create one template that you can push out to many, many different sites. The idea of dynamic site templates is that if you have a change, for instance, you've pushed out a corporate theme, for instance, to many different departments, your departmental administrators are actually creating the sites, and you change your corporate logo. Instead of going to the five or six or seven different places where that particular template is being used, you change the master template, you update your logo, automatically it propagates across all the different sites that that template is being used. So it allows you as an administrator to tightly control look and feel, UI, theming, branding for everywhere that a template is being pushed out. Same thing with page templates. We have the ability to do creation of pre-configured pages. Perhaps you want to be able to have a page that's set out for a particular department. You want to control what they're using and what they see in that page. You can pre-configure a page, or you can pre-configure a whole website. You can have a whole website completely themed out and available as a drop-down template. And let me just show you very quickly how that would look like. So, for instance, I'm going to add something over here. I've got some templates in here. I can add a blog page, for instance. All right, so I'm going to add a blog, which has already been templated out. And the template has all this different stuff in it already. It has all this stuff in it. All right, so we pre-created that particular blog page. So it gives you the ability to control and very easily push out to your particular users themed and templated types of sites and pages. Let me see, site management. Let me just hop ahead here very quickly. I've talked about workflow. Hop ahead very quickly. So we do have a collaboration suite. I mentioned earlier that when we were showing you the port list, everything's kind of categorized. But we have blogs, wikis, message boards, enterprise chat, ratings and comments, this very Facebook kind of like features that is really becoming more and more prevalent within enterprise. More and more companies are using this because it boosts productivity of their users. It's not simply users going out to Facebook and playing and chatting with their friends, but rather using that in an enterprise capacity for business. So the idea behind these tagging and categorizations, ratings and comment, really plays to this concept of social equity or social activity. So sorry about that. Social equity, the ability to build, I think one of the terms that's becoming more used widely is something called gamification. The ability to actually earn equity or earn points or earn status within your organization by the amount that you contribute. So for instance, you can set up a system where if somebody posts a blog, they earn so many points. And if somebody gets so many plus ones for their blog, they earn more points. And they gain status. And what this encourages, it encourages your users, your workers, the people within your enterprise to contribute positively to the community of your particular organization. If you put you know, a rant post. Nobody's going to plus one it. Nobody's going to, you know, thumbs up it. Nobody's going to read it. You're not going to get views. So it discourages negative types of contributions. It encourages things that will actually edify and build up your company, this idea. And you'll find, and what we've found is that people buy into this very easily because they're used to it. They've seen it before. They do it in Facebook. They want to have their comments and their posts liked as much as possible. You put that into an enterprise type of situation, you'll find that people really begin to become more productive in terms of what they're contributing. Within Liferay, we use a Star Wars theme. So X amount of message board posts or X amount of blogs, you become from a Padawan to a Jedi, and then, you know, and become a Jedi master, etc. We have all broken down. So, you know, depending on how much you contribute and how well you contribute, we build up status. And then, of course, you can turn that into maybe reward points. You know, somebody gets so many statuses, they earn a day off. Somebody gets so many statuses, they get a gift card to, you know, American Express gift card, whatever the case may be. Lots of different ways that you can use that. But that's all built into Liferay, the gamification, the idea of social equity. I mentioned earlier a little bit about Alloy UI, and I think I'm going to defer that to Savoir-Faire to talk a little bit more about the more technical aspects of it. I'm going to just very quickly, I also want to mention accessibility, a big issue in the U.S., I'm sure here in this country as well. We have a standard called WCAG 2.0 that we comply with. Basically, it's compatible with building dynamic webs, building applications using Web 2.0 techniques. Especially within the U.S. government, we have something called the 508 compliancy, which is a law that dictates that websites that are 508 compliant must be compliant so that handicapped people can have access to them, blind people can have access to them, text readers can be able to access them, etc. Liferay is completely compatible and supports these different functionalities. Really, it's how you develop the theme. Extensibility and integration. We do provide a SAML identity provider hook, one of the new features of 6.1. Aside from supporting LDAP, OpenSSO, OpenID, CAS, SiteMinder, NTLM, all the different SSOs we support out of the box, what we've added in 6.1 is support for SAML, not simply as a service provider. So it's not simply as a provider for SAML, but also as an IDP, as an identity provider. The neat thing about it is that you can actually set Liferay up as a federated credential provider if you don't have a third-party SSO, or if you wanted to have a parallel SSO, you can use Liferay as your single sign-on provider to then access other applications or other resources. Ability to create custom fields, extending all of your custom, all the fields that we've been talking about, for all your assets. You can create custom fields very easily, whether it's users, your organizations, your pages, your documents, etc. Anything that we don't provide out of the box, it's all extensible. You can create that very easily. Again, no development here. We're just talking about configuration. No database changes is required. It automatically updates your database tables if you create custom fields or extend the fields within a particular asset type. Asset framework, again, the ability to take what assets do we have out of the box and create your own custom assets. You can leverage everything that we already have and reuse what we have to be able to create other custom content types that fit your particular needs. And of course, you can do all that from plugins. We have a rules integration engine that allows you to build intelligence into portlets using the Drools language. So another phrase that's used for this is targeted content. So for instance, one user logs in from Montreal, and they look at a website, and they see Montreal weather. And another user logs in from Los Angeles, and they can be looking at the same URL, same web page, same portlet, but be looking at Los Angeles weather. You build that intelligence into the portlet that says, I want to know what city this particular user is from. And based on that particular piece of information, we target the content to that user. Now, that might be kind of a very simplistic use of it, but we can pull any attribute from any user, their role, their name, their gender, any metadata associated with the user, where they're from, what sites they belong to. We can even pull their behavior. What was the last 5 pages this user viewed? Based on that information, we are now going to present this targeted content. So you can see there's a lot of commercial implications here. A user has been looking at soccer balls the last 5 pages, all right? So based on that information, you're going to show him soccer uniforms, maybe soccer balls, maybe soccer shoes, whatever the case may be that you think might be interesting to them. So very much the same way like Amazon or some of these other large e-commerce engines use that kind of intelligence. That's built into Liferay. You can use that within Liferay. Developer Studio I spoke about very earlier in terms of the development environment that that we use. And again, everything that I've spoke about so far is extensible and customizable. Our approach in Liferay, our philosophy is to embrace this idea of openness, open source, open standards, you being able to take what we give you, and if we give you 90, 95% of what you need out of the box, we give you the ability to take it that last 5% without extensive customization. It's not a huge customization effort. It's not a huge development effort. Integrating, bringing custom portlets is an effort that takes days as opposed to months and months and months. And that's something that Savoir-Faire, our partner here, can do for you. They can explain a little bit more in terms of the actual effort to create customizations within Liferay. Analytics and management is built into Liferay. We have a built-in auditing portlet, auditing framework that allows you to track any usage, usage within the portal. What anybody's doing, how many times this page has been viewed, how many times that person has logged in. And once you've been able to do that, you can use the UI to do the query, the audit logs, and then you can actually pipe that into a reports generation portlet. We support Jasper reports. We support BIRT out of the box. Basically, that allows you to use Jaspersoft to create reports definition, upload them into an existing portlet, and be able to query all the data that you've been collecting in the auditing framework. Integrating other business intelligence tools, very simple, very straightforward. A lot of our customers will integrate IBM Cognos or whatever the case may be. So you can use whatever reports engine that you want. Performance and monitoring, we support JMX extensions, which allows you to have a graphical view of what's going on in the portal. So this is important for your system administrators that want to fine-tune their cache or see how their clusters are performing. All this information is available within Liferay. So I hope that I covered everything and I stayed within time. Any questions, anything that I've talked about or anything that I didn't show you that you would like to see, I can show you very quickly.